Greetings, citizens, and thanks for tuning in to Nindie Nation. I'm Jeff, and today on episode 198, we're checking out the best new indie releases coming to the Nintendo Switch eShop this week. If you dig these videos, click the like button, subscribe for more weekly updates, and be sure to shout out your picks this week down in the comments or over on Discord. And by the way, thanks for the great response in last week's deals video. We got a lot of new subscribers, so to any of you Nindie newcomers, welcome! I really hope you don't think this episode sucks, but I guess there's only one way to find out. These are the 8 new notable Nindies hitting the Nintendo Switch through Sunday, December 3rd. If you come here for reductive, sarcastic takes on new indie games, strap in, because Roots of Pacha drops on Tuesday the 28th, and it's basically Stardew Valley, but cavemen. However, I think Soda Den, who recently took home a nomination from Day of the Devs, deserve a bit more credit than that. The game does take place in the Stone Age, so in addition to farming, crafting, and all of that stuff, you're also coming up with ideas or creating new inventions for the first time. Not sure if that makes the game play any differently, but the context is neat. You'll develop tools, guide your clan's spirituality, and develop relationships by learning about the fears and dreams of your fellow townsfolk. And most of the primary tasks revolve around mini-games that are much deeper and more involved than they may look. Speaking of looks, visually it looks great, a lot like Stardew Valley, but more refined and with plenty of its own charm. I like that the various areas you can explore, like nearby waters, caves, jungles, and so on, all have a unique feel and vibe. The game looks great, and early access players have really been digging it. So if Caveman Valley seems up your alley,
hey, that rhymed.
It seems like a safe bet to check out Roots of Pacha when it releases for $24.99.
I'm a poet and I didn't know it.
But then we're already at the big Thursday drop, and I have a beef to pick with Twin Otter Studios because I had no idea that Arcadian Atlas was finally dropping on the Switch. And this is a game I've been following since the Kickstarter launched all the way back in 2016. The studio was formed by siblings Becca and Taylor Bear, with the whole game developed by only 4 people, of which I believe one of them is Konjac, the developer of Iconoclasts, who is married to Becca Bear. Anyways, as you can tell, this game is a lovingly crafted homage to Final Fantasy Tactics, the turn-based, fantasy-themed strategy RPG that has been listed as an inspiration to almost every game in the genre since its release in 1997. When Arcadian Atlas released on Steam last year, reviews were very mixed. People seemed to love the game's story and its jazzy soundtrack, but felt it lacked the polish and performance needed to rise above similar titles. I will admit that makes me a bit wary about the Switch version, and as such, I caution you to watch and read reviews if you're as excited for the game as I am. That said, I'm a bit biased because I've watched the development of this game for so long, and I really want the game to succeed, so I've already pre-ordered it and will report back. But if you like what you see and you're comfortable with where the reviews land, you too can pick it up by way of Serenity Forge with a 10% launch discount of $17.99. Look, I get it, guys. Cats, pixel art, cozy farming, crafting, and all of that stuff. There's a lot of it, but this next one is kinda standing out, so let's talk about it. In 2018, back when pixel art cat games weren't 40% of every indie world presentation, a small team called Falcon released Cat Tales. It was a pretty fun, simple RPG where you, well, it's an RPG with all kinds of RPG stuff where you play as a cat in a world of cats. I think you get the picture. Well, after a ton of DLC, a couple side stories, and a bunch of growth over at Falcon, they're back this week with Cat Tales Wildwood Story for $19.99. This time around, it's more of a cozy life sim. Still retains most of the RPG aspects from the original, but instead of a primary focus on action RPG combat, This one's a bit more about raising a village of cats, providing for them, and then protecting the village from attackers. So the combat is a bit more like tower defense, but there's still an open world to explore, level up, find materials in, and all that stuff. The game only released a month ago on Steam, and it's already secured an overwhelmingly positive rating, with a ton of reviews. So for the right audience, it's very much hitting the mark. Either you like this kind of game or you don't, but if you do, and especially if you're a cat person, this is one that's worth checking out. By the way, are you a cat person? Do you own a cat or cats? If so, tell me the name of your cat or cats down in the comments. And for those of you with a love for games like this, we've got This Means Warp, which is a
zany multiplayer party game with a gimmick,
where that gimmick is surviving in space with up to four players, online or off. Already raking in the positive reviews on Steam, the gameplay sits somewhere between Overcooked, FTL or Into the Breach, and Lovers in a Dangerous Space-Time. In fact, one could say that This Means Warp is a sci-fi co-op survival game with procedurally generated levels, roguelike mechanics, and RPG elements! Each run is unique, and with upgradable characters and ships, you can play whatever role you want. You can focus on repairs and steering the ship, take control of the firepower and focus on battles, or you can even do things like teleport to the enemy ships and knock them out from within. And it looks really fun. It releases for $19.99, and while I'm not usually all over this kind of game, the work from Nindie newcomer Outlier Games and publisher Jagex makes this a promising new entry in an otherwise crowded genre. But let's take a quick break from the games that most likely are worth your time and touch on a couple of games that, I don't know, these aren't recommendations, but more like little curiosities that, given their balance of indie jank, a cheaper price, and potentially unknown developers, are what I like to call the negligible nindies. Toaster Ball is another
zany multiplayer party game with a gimmick,
where this gimmick is a $10 take on Pong, where everyone plays as a toaster. It looks simple and dorky, but the glowing Steam reviews claim it's much deeper than it seems. So I'm gonna keep an eye on this clever little game that's brought to us by
The Crafters.
Corbett, A Colorful Adventure is a $12 3D platformer focused on maze-like levels with puzzles throughout. It's from Barcelonian studio Koo Curry, but the publisher Meridium Games has been known to force titles out before they're ready. So the game looks fun, but definitely check reviews before depositing your digital dollars. Oh, hey, have you ever wondered what it'd be like to be a 30-year-old Korean man who's never had a girlfriend and must now win the heart of a Korean woman via full-motion video dating? If so, and you've got 20 bucks, Modi Solo, No Girlfriend Since Birth is, well, it's something. Jandusoft has Crashy Laps for $6.99. It's basically RC Pro-Am or one of those isometric racing games from back in the day. I wouldn't expect any frills, but for what it is, it doesn't seem that bad.
How's that for a back-of-the-box quote?
And I know several of you citizens dig those super cheap 3D platformers like Tori or Super Kiwi 64. Ortheo is the latest game in the bunch. This time coming from Elucius and Larsensoft for $1.99, it's an open-world, momentum-based platformer, so you'll be exploring big, simple, but mostly empty spaces, while moving quickly and collecting all the things to reach the next area. Then we've got Speed or Death by Dolores Entertainment, and this arcade racer brings all the chaos, destruction, and redonkulous scenarios that I love in games like Cruisin' Blast. The studio was kind enough to offer a copy so I could try it for myself, but I haven't received it yet, so just like with Low Story a couple weeks back, the text on screen right now will tell you what I thought of this $8 arcade racer. And rounding out this section, we've got Space Junk Seekers by Stephen O'Gorman, who recently released the Hero Hours contract games, and this carries the same vivid anime style alongside a pretty simple premise. You float around in space, trying to pick up good junk while avoiding or shooting the bad junk. I guess there's some hologram person that provides context and a story behind all of the junk you'll be gathering across four worlds. But really, for $2, if this style vibes with you, it's probably worth checking out. And back to the land of trying to creatively describe the same type of game over and over, just pretend you're watching an indie world as I tell you about what makes Pixel Cafe different.
I kid.
You follow a small town girl who's trying to navigate her coming of age story, where half of the time you're working out personal relationships through visual novel style conversations. The rest of your time is spent in a mobile game time management minigame where you balance the needs of various patrons at your cafe, serving coffee and food in the most efficient way possible. This one's developed by Baltoro Games, and it does feel like a slight cut above the usual fare we see in this genre. With a story that seems interesting, at least based on the trailers, and gameplay that evolves over time, if you feel like tapping into your inner emo barista, you can do so for $12.99. But the other game that I'm really excited to check out this week, and the title which wraps up the big Thursday drop, really couldn't have come at a better time. As you'll see in a minute, I'm kinda loathing the fact that the new SteamWorld game has nothing to do with digging, but that just makes WallWorld all the more exciting. Developed by Alawar Premium, a self-professed mid-core studio based in Delaware, this game literally turns the SteamWorld dig formula on its side. You live in a huge robotic spider and must climb up the never-ending walls of your world. When you find a spot of interest, you exit the spider and float around in a randomized Metroidvania-like mine, mining and gathering resources to help you develop new technology to go further. When you're out of the mine, you'll upgrade your robo-spider to help you make it to the next area, and that's where the new technology comes into play. Bad guys don't like that you're climbing their wall and mining for resources, so you gotta develop and deploy traps that'll help protect your robo-spider through tower defense-like gameplay. It adds an additional layer of gameplay that should keep the time spent away from the mining part more challenging and engaging. With a slew of biomes, dozens of upgrades, and a never-ending stream of new areas to explore, WallWorld is a side-scrolling action-adventure with procedurally generated levels, roguelike mechanics, and RPG elements! And if you happen to be as intrigued by this one as I am, you'll be pleased to know that it releases for $9.99. Two more titles this week, releasing on Friday, December 1st, and since I already teased it, we'll just start with SteamWorld Build. Look, I'm not the best person to talk to you about this game, because for as much as I love SteamWorld Dig, Dig 2, and Heist, I bailed about halfway through Quest and really have no interest in Build. The premise is cool though. A last-ditch effort to escape a dying planet, you gotta build a rocket, but of course it's way more complicated than it seems. The material you need is underground, but to support a network of robots mining underground, you'll need to build a city above to support the processing of what they find. So the game's kinda split in two. The town building and management aspect is mostly what you'd expect. You're managing an economy, shops, citizens, happiness, and all that kind of stuff, while of course slowly building the aforementioned rocket. Underground, though, is where you'll send an ever-expanding army of robots to do the actual mining work. But when they're attacked by underground monsters, it turns into more of a tower defense game. The stuff underground benefits the stuff above ground, and the stuff above ground supports further work underground. It's a pretty cool idea, and I'm sure it'll be reviewed pretty well given the team's history, but I don't know. Maybe if it gets rave reviews, I'll check it out, but I'd really love to see another SteamWorld heist, personally. For those of you who are planning to pick this up, it'll cost you $30, and if you do happen to pick it up, please let me know how it is. Is it good enough to stand toe-to-toe against other games in the genre? Or is it maybe good enough to attract a much broader audience? Alright, last game, Friday. You know what that means, it's Rattleika's release for the week, And for $5, Zomborg looks like a fun, mindless way to spend a few hours mowing down zombies. It's just a top-down twin-stick shooter, but it brings customizable characters, NPCs to team up with, and lots of upgrades to unlock. Sure, it looks janky as all hell, but hey, if the gameplay's fun and it runs okay, I see nothing wrong with the simple fun of rampaging through thousands of reanimated corpses. Hey, for the 33% of you who typically do, thanks for sticking around till the end. In fact, I'll tell you what, head down to the comments, let me know which games are scratching your itch this week, and say something nice about another commenter, and I'll pick one of the replies to get a free Switch game code. No promises on what it is, though. For me, I'm definitely most interested in Arcadian Atlas and Wall World, but I'm still intrigued by Space Junk Seekers, Speed or Death, and Zomborg too. Next week, we've got a couple of ports that are finally making their way to the Switch, with Skater XL,
which I'm not holding my breath over,
and The Outer Wilds, which I'm really excited to see a whole new group of people get the chance to experience it for the first time. However, it's the comedic action RPG tropes in Born of Bread that I'm most looking forward to, and then before you know it, we'll be at episode 200. But we'll have to save that for next week, citizens, because we're all done for today. Thanks so much for watching, liking, subscribing, and sharing Nindie Nation with others. Until next week, I'm Jeff. This has been Nindie Nation episode 198. And remember, no matter what type of game you're looking for, Nindie Nation will be right here to help you find just the thing to keep your Joy-Cons synced.